Hello everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, In-Depth Security for the Agile Network, Part 3, Building a Comprehensive Cybersecurity Solution. My name is John Feld, and I'll be your moderator. I'd like to introduce today's panelists. Eric Youngens, Senior Technical Marketing Engineer at Palo Alto Networks, provides guidance and thought leadership in developing unified and cohesive strategies leveraged for combating the modern-day threat landscape. Joseph Richardson is Senior Director, Cybersecurity Products at Comcast Business. On behalf of Comcast Business, I'd like to welcome you again to In-Depth Security for the Agile Network, Part 3, Building a Comprehensive Cybersecurity Solution. In the first parts of this series, we explored the current threat environment and real-time remediation. Today, we'll discuss what it takes to create a comprehensive layered solution. While there is no one-size-fits-all answer, there are components that can work together to support any business. Eric, what have been the most recent pernicious threats?
Yes. Very good question, John. So from where I sit in our organization here at Palo Alto Networks, I'm always escalated to when our customers or potential customers actually experience a breach and or actually experience a malware incident. So really what that means for us is we get typically some cases insider information as to how these adversaries are gaining access to users in terms of resources and other aspects of the organization. Case in point, we actually have seen an actual ransomware situation that played out inside of a healthcare organization. Obviously, we just saw the U.S. government publishing a number of information about this over the past few days. But in this case, we actually saw a single user that was impacted by a single piece of malware delivered to that user's email box. That user was infected for a short period of time, maybe a few days or so, before that user and the information as well as the access that user had to the rest of the healthcare environment was utilized to actually spread laterally ransomware inside the environment. So really what happened from start to finish was a single user, single email, single click turned into a extremely widespread ransomware outbreak on the interior of their network infrastructure by just leveraging the single access point they have within this particular user. It was kind of deployed in a way it was using, you know, a combination of stolen credentials and the combination of having access to a single user, but also because of the really the inside of the organization that was compromised, there really was no security control past the perimeter. And time and time again, we're seeing this where, you know, customers focus so heavily on what is exterior facing in security and do not focus on the interior facing security aspect.
So this was almost what would be akin to a super spreader event starting at just a single point?
Absolutely. It was a single person inside the healthcare environment, not even a doctor, not a nurse. This is just a general personnel within the environment. And absolutely, it was absolutely a super spreader event.
And it shows just how kind of how vulnerable everybody is. Eric, also clearly phishing remains a critical issue. Can you describe how the threat might unfold?
Absolutely. So this is actually taken directly from the playbook we saw play out inside this organization as well. So this started with a business document. Now, the reason why the adversary started with a business document, in this case, is the Microsoft Office Word document. They started there because they knew that there would be no blocking or potential scanning of a standard Microsoft Office document on its way into the organization. So once they actually delivered the actual document to the user, when the user actually opened the document and executed the macro or the embedded information inside of the document, it called out to a number of compromised URLs. Now, what's clear here is really what the adversary is really thinking is that in almost all cases, an email security product isn't directly connected to a web filtering product. So essentially, if you weren't able to see the email and understand the email was malicious, you wouldn't understand that the compromised URLs that were being accessed when the document was executed were actually malicious as well. So by using compromised URLs, essentially they skirt around typical URL filtering deployments by avoiding detection. Now, once they've actually, or once the user has clicked on the actual document, executed the macro, called to these compromised URLs, that is when the adversary delivers secondary and tertiary payloads. What we mean by this is that additional pieces of malware to get a very distinct foothold inside of the environment. Now, that can be done in a couple different ways, but the end goal of this is to get full control over the environment, full control over the user's PC, figure out where in the environment other resources may live. So in this case, basically finding file shares, finding databases, finding other servers, and then using that landing point or that single person to be, again, that super spreader event moving laterally inside of the environment.
And I think it's worth noting that you talk about the compromised URL, and we're seeing that more and more in nearly undetectable compromise such as puny code, things like that, where to the naked eye, these are compromises that are really hard to see and just vowel changes and things like that. Is that right?
Oh, absolutely. In some cases, these are legitimate websites. If you go to the top-level domain, we were just looking at one yesterday. There's a number of vulnerabilities about Screen Connect. Screen Connect is an actual IT support application that you can purchase and host yourself. We actually saw yesterday an actor that was using a compromised Screen Connect account, meaning that you went to the top-level domain, you get the exact website you'd expect. If you went to a subdirectory on that website, you would actually see a number of different malware samples. So, again, understanding that most URL filtering devices aren't connected with email services, so that adversary's understanding of that basically gives them the leg up, almost, in some cases, to be able to basically cause some damage inside of an environment.
And, Joe, where are businesses most vulnerable right now and why?
So, for me, the vulnerability exists because there's been a huge shift from our defensible position, which has been at the corporate D mark, and now that we are in a COVID situation, people have moved home. And even though, to Eric's point, it's about attacks coming in, and that is the typical security that is applied, and sometimes you have a threshold situation that he just described where the URL comes in, download, secondary, tertiary payloads. Now that has changed because you are working from home. And now you're sharing space with family members, your spouse, you know, children, and all this is a co-mingling of the network traffic, whether it is actual personal, academic-related, if you're thinking about children going from school, or even work-related. And if both spouses are working remotely, two different sets of policies that are existing on the same wireless network in your house. So if you don't have the secure controls for your remote workforce, now you have a threat vector that may actually exist to your corporate environment in your own home. So I would say that we have to focus on moving away from the centralized model and starting to understand how we secure these islands of remote workers and the data that may reside on their systems or in the cloud systems that may be accessing from their homes. So distribution in and out of itself has created these avenues of the workforce and has expanded the threat landscape. So I would say we need to address that. We need to come up with new strategies of how we secure our home workers in these co-mingled environments.
And if you think about that sort of level of threat expansion, Eric, from your perspective, you actually bring gamers into the equation. So let's talk about their impact and your perspective on vulnerabilities in general.
Yeah, so it's been very interesting. So, as Palo Alto Networks, we're a company of about 8,000 people. We transitioned to remote work almost immediately during the start of the pandemic. And we've seen, and we work directly with our customers in trying to implement large-scale VPN solutions through our Prisma Access solutions, other capabilities. But one thing that's been really apparent, and even interacting with some of my other colleagues that have children at home, either gamers or online learning, et cetera, gaming in general or online gaming has been kind of ripe with, people that are really trying to affect the game by knocking people offline with DDoS attempts, et cetera. And obviously that affects the home remote employees as well. And to that end, I think there's really kind of a situation we're finding ourselves in right now where, some customers and some, companies have really struggled to spin up remote access solutions for their entire company in some cases very quickly. So they kind of tend to cut corners. We've seen in some cases where customers have exposed remote desktop services or remote access services without multi-factor authentication, or in some cases just exposing certain services because it would make it easier for the business to continue. But that also makes it very, very easy for the adversary to gain access to those resources as well. Just like we've seen with some of the recent publishing of ransomware outbreaks and discussions by the U.S. government, we've seen adversaries targeting remote access services with credentials they've stolen from the employee prior to even attempting to log in. So essentially, to you as a person, a practitioner of security inside of an organization, you see Joe logging in from California just like he always had, even though Joe in California is not really Joe, it's an adversary using his credentials to gain access to the resources available. Now, if you expand upon that and think about all the other resources that are available typically externally on the internet from a typical organization, there's even more avenues for the adversary to gain access and take advantage of that situation.
And I would imagine that along with those avenues to access, you have hackers who are getting increasingly creative about getting in there, gaining credentials and the like. Is that not correct?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Time and time again, we see brand reuse or brand recognition reuse. So meaning sending an email that appears to be from Microsoft, Google, et cetera, but also from the company that they're trying to attempt to attack. We've seen this actually in the last week with an organization that was receiving repetitive emails about invoices being due with their own company logo inside the email, and actually from an email address internally to that organization. So the adversary is smart. They were leveraging, you know, the trust, inherent trust of email systems to try and spread themselves within the organization.
And, you know, we talked about business vulnerabilities. Eric, how can specific applications be exploited?
So this is actually really interesting. We've seen this time and time again with large-scale and small-scale organizations where the exposed services, so meaning your typical web server, your email server, other aspects of your business, either exposed in the cloud or on-premise or both, essentially have, you know, vulnerabilities, especially in cloud-based services where it's somewhat difficult to patch when it comes to exposed services, or also have the same security controls you have in the cloud as you would as an on-premise type solution. Really, adversaries look for the weakest point inside of an organization in order to follow through with their efforts. So in this case, actually, we did a demonstration of this last year at one of our big conferences where an adversary, we watched them from start to finish, gain access to an externally published application, so a legitimate application that had some vulnerabilities inside. Once they gained access to that single application, they then kind of looked around within the ecosystem to see what other access they had. So adjacent database servers, adjacent email servers, et cetera. Once they were able to figure out what they had in their landscape and what they had access to, they immediately crawled through all of them, exfiltrated data, and then held that data for ransom externally from the organization.
And I would imagine that so that we're talking about applications in a general sense, now that you've got this incredibly distributed network of employees and others, I imagine their own applications on their own devices also offer entree. Does that make sense?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. So obviously, you know, vulnerabilities on a local level absolutely are just as much as in play as an exposed service.
Joe, what were you going to say?
No, I was going to agree on that. Especially, and I also think about some of the situations where you have devices in your home that are part of the new IoT wave, and understanding if you don't actually protect your firewall at home, that you may actually have listening devices from hackers sitting there on your light bulb, for example, or even your thermostat.
Wow. So all of that IoT stuff is almost as exposed as other entryways.
Potentially, yes.
Wow. And, you know, speaking of that vulnerability, Joe, can you offer one or two examples of recent breaches or attacks that have been particularly egregious?
So one very egregious attack that I look to is the one that happened at the Maersk Corporation. So basically, there was malware that was propagated by a nation state in Europe that actually hit the Maersk system. Now, Maersk is a shipping company that basically has global logistics and is part of the global supply chain. And in the end, they were not able to track their shipments. There was an installation of ransomware across their network, and all of their Active Directory servers had been shut down. I mean, I'm paraphrasing here, but it was a very bad event. And this was actually, I believe, in the Wall Street Journal and or Wired Magazine. And so for them to actually recover, there was one actual Active Directory server that was in Africa that they had to fly the hard drives from there to rebuild their entire Active Directory infrastructure to bring everybody back online. Now, while this is happening, basically global logistics shipping stopped, and there was physical impacts and economic impacts from the workers all the way down to the corporations, to the companies that were shipping, to the companies that were receiving, whether it's dry goods, meat, things of that nature. So when you think about it, and again, to Eric's point, this was innocuous malware created by a nation state, but that actually got into a corporate network and basically shut them down and has ramifications across the entire global chain and to economies, not always easily measured. And I think this is just the new expansion of a connected world, and that if we don't have the proper boundaries in place, you can have a ripple effect across our entire ecosystem.
And Eric, can you give us an example from your own experience and sort of what the resulting issues were?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And it's very interesting to kind of build on Joe's point. There was recently in the news another organization in Europe, an energy company, where they were compromised. In this case, the adversary was a bit smarter than they were before. This is actually the second time this organization has had a large-scale breach. But essentially, when they gained access to the environment, they first exfiltrated all of the available data they could find. Now, the reason why they exfiltrated the data to begin with was that when they went to their second stage, which was deployment of ransomware, it was really a combination of extortion alongside ransomware. They basically threatened to expose all of the internal data about their internal dealings, their, you know, obviously political maneuvers they're trying to put into play for different regulatory changes within the EU. And that was the impetus for enlarging the ransom that they were willing, or basically what they were charging to the user for unlocking the data. So we're seeing this time and time again where adversaries are beginning to be smarter, understanding again situational awareness, where they land, what they have access to, and leveraging that information to really garner a larger payout from large-scale organizations. Now, if you flip that on its head and, you know, compare that to some of the situations that are happening or playing out in healthcare organizations today, recently in the news, I think it was about a few months ago, there was a direct correlation between an actual human casualty to a malware incident happening inside of a hospital system. So this is the first time where we've actually seen a direct correlation between a person who was on their way to a hospital that had to be redirected because care was unavailable. That person then passed away in the process of being redirected to the other location. So to Joe's point, even, you know, more distinctly, there is a real-world implication for what's happening in the threat landscape today. I think it will only continue in the next few years, if not, you know, further on from that, if we as a collective, we, so to speak, don't focus a lot more energy on really trying to fortify and protect all of our assets and all of our people in ways that are appropriate for today's threat landscape.
And it helps to understand, too, that it's not always just as the case in ransomware, you're looking at an immediate financial benefit. If you look at all of the resulting issues from this, the fatality that you mentioned, the fact that world markets can be put at risk, I would guess that there are bad actors out there who aren't just in it for the money. Some of them actually seem to enjoy the disruption based on what they're doing.
Absolutely. I would not say that we are not far away, if not has already happened, maybe not necessarily been publicized, about, you know, just corporate espionage in this context as well. I mean, if you think about this, this is beginnings of where, you know, corporations can fight each other virtually to some degree, and with probably great results.
Joe, what are the current keys in your mind to infrastructure network protection and even to a degree external device protection?
So I think I've been in technology for about 20 plus years, starting off in systems administration. So I think if we started talking about technology, we could be here all day and people would leave and be bored. So I want to take it to a really high level. And one of the founding principles was the CIA triad, which is confidentiality, integrity, and availability. And I think all the rules, regulations that we have in place, the frameworks have come out of that. And I would say, you know, the DoD actually posted two additional pillars, which is authenticity and non-repudiation of user data. So whatever you're doing for your infrastructure network, external device, wherever your data is located, you want to have those five things in mind. You have to know that the data is clean at all times, so you know that. So when you talk about ransomware, for example, you want to make sure that data is always available, whether it's on-premise or in the cloud. Confidentiality, let's just say that's encryption. Also making sure that people only have the right roles and access to the data, especially if you're talking about intellectual property. When it's multi, if we're talking about authenticity, non-repudiation, then we're really starting to get into like multi-factor authentication, biometrics, et cetera. So we want to make sure that these are the five things that you apply to your infrastructure. However you decide to implement it in your network, whether it's on-premise at the corporate environment or at, for your remote workforce, use that as your guiding principle, and you will find the right technology solutions, you will find the right partners, and then be able to, at all times, make sure that your data is protected and your workforce is protected from any intrusions, internal or external.
And Eric, beyond this, kind of those five pillars, do you see other opportunities potentially being missed for protection?
Absolutely. So, you know, to Joe's point, he made some fantastic points there as well. You know, one thing that we consistently see here, at least from my purview and the customers that I interact with, is lack of consistency. And I mean this kind of in an interesting way. If you think about, you know, how you protect your home, you typically have your, you know, obviously locks and keys in every door that faces your external property, alongside alarm systems, alongside other things. If you equate that to a typical business today, in some cases they may have locks and keys and alarm systems at their front door, but not on their side doors or on every employee that's out in the world. I think that's where we're seeing a lot of challenges with security technologies and implementation of security technologies, that the focus is always on a certain aspect of where the business potentially has impact without recognizing the fact that there's just as much impact if users or other aspects of your organization are also compromised.
So essentially, you really need to take a broader view when you're thinking about that protection and understand that there may be more places you're vulnerable than you even realize.
Absolutely. I mean, take an example of a cloud-based environment or hybrid cloud deployment. You know, most people tend to think that the cloud-based providers have security built into their stack, and the reality is that is absolutely not the case. In fact, Microsoft has many presentations on the customers they have and the situations they've seen their customers in. It's not because Microsoft doesn't care or can't help, but you know, you can't repair or fix someone else's systems in some way, shape, or form in cloud environments. You really need to make sure that, again, you have the same consistent capabilities in all areas of your environment for security purposes.
Right. So once again, that consistency is a watchword. And as far as when we talk about these comprehensive security solutions, Eric, what does a business need to be effective but not overcomplicated in terms of solutions and implementation?
Yeah, and I think it really kind of starts with understanding where your users are, where your data lives, and what you really need to protect. I think a lot of security functionality tends to typically focus on either HR use cases, so an example of URL filtering. I want to make sure no one in my organization can see sites that I don't expect them to see in their course of business. When the reality is, there's actually a number of other use cases for URL filtering that fall well outside of just HR. When we start thinking of these types of scenarios, focusing on users, data, and accessibility, and things you need to protect, then you start to basically shift your mindset a bit to understand where you should be focusing efforts and how and what technologies you should be implementing to focus your efforts on as well. I think if you take it one step further, the organization today doesn't understand those pieces. Again, where your data is, who has access to the data, and where they are, you really don't have the capability of actually securing the data. And that, I think, is a really salient point for everyone to remind themselves of. Always think about in that context. If you don't have that understanding, it's going to be very, very difficult for you to keep a rein in and actually apply the security controls you need for the organization.
So to that point, and from what you've said, it's sort of a reverse engineering the process around what you need, and about a discovery phase, it really should be up front.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And Joe, what are the components that, in your view, comprise a comprehensive security solution kind of now and in the future?
I would start with authentication and authorization, the ability to know who's logging into your network at any time, authenticating them properly, and then assigning them the proper access or role in your environment. I think of it as your typical government scenario where you have classified data and making sure that the only people who have been certified or vetted to view certain data have that ability. And that's also talking about network access. The next thing is really protecting your data, whether it's in transit or it is actually at rest. So some of the things like SSL decryption or just encrypting all your data streams and making sure there's no malware in any of your network streams. So now we're talking about that no matter what people are doing, whether it is encrypted, clear text, whatever have you have the ability at any time to make sure that no data is being exfiltrated and that there's no malware being passed around, especially when there's a threshold situation and you may have malware jumping from one host to another. Then also, to Eric's point, if the data is distributed like across the cloud, you need to know where your data is at all times and protect it at rest. So when you put this together, your users, your customers are actually accessing it, you'll need to be able to authenticate them and authorize them, and then you know exactly who's actually accessing your data. Again, that's another control that's in place. I would say if you can figure out these components, and again, it's on a case-by-case basis for your business, then you'll be able to pick up which security technologies, going back to my previous slide, that you'll need to specifically secure it, fits within your budget, and you can actually roll out and implement. Some are complementary, some are not. And to Eric's point, you also want to be, I would say, consistent in terms of what you are doing in your environment. If you make it too complex, it's not easy to manage, and therefore, it just creates too many problems for your staff, and that's when there are the ability of attacks will actually come into your environment and not be checked.
So that, in that sense, in that management sense, what by creating a complex solution or one that's difficult to manage, you're actually almost opening gaps up.
Correct.
Okay.
It has to be easy to operate.
Right. And Joe, in taking a layered approach, are there ways to cost-effectively upgrade existing solutions? And in that sense, how does it change the infrastructure and architecture?
That's a tough question. I think if you have actually started down the path of securing your environment, you are kind of tied into the roadmap and the evolution of the products that you purchased, and then you want to potentially buy additional services, products to actually integrate, it can become complex, and you really have to understand the integration points for all those products themselves in terms of the portfolio, where they're going. I would say behind the scenes in the overall security community, you want to try to build, there is a push that's been out there for the last couple of years to build a framework for interoperability between the products. So just because companies understand that if they are building something monolithic now, that they won't be able to actually play later on in the market. So they are really pushing that effort. So I think right now, you know, organizations need to look at how multiple solutions interact with each other so they can provide the agility that the business needs and that they can secure all their assets. Whether it's, again, we're back to being either on-premise, off-premise, in transit, at rest, and authenticating and authorizing users at all times.
And so in that case, in that scenario, you're looking at interoperability, and you're looking at the way that it all works together. So how do monitoring and mitigation work in concert in that kind of scenario?
Monitoring and mitigation is now we're getting into the whole idea around the SOC. I think you have to be able to take in the volumes of data because there's a ton of data out there that can be generated by these devices and make it actionable and respond properly to whatever's happening and defend your environment in real time. I think that's going to be the next evolution. That's when people talk about things like AI and ML, machine learning, and all those other great terms that are coming out every day. And I think once we are able to build automated responses that reduce false positives, and we're able to actually mitigate any type of attack that's occurring, I think that's really where we're going.
Mm-hmm. And Eric, to Joe's point, what role does automation play?
Yeah, it's really funny because automation at this point in the SOC is really the name of the game. We work with not only our own internal SOC, but also external SOCs involved in large-scale and small-scale networks, ensuring that all the tooling, all the functionality, all the capabilities are built into your security stack to have the ability to respond when you need. So whether it's a manual process, whether it's AI or ML-driven, but really understanding the information you have available to you, taking swift and quick action when there is a potential incident in play. We were just talking with a SOC yesterday, actually, for a very, very large media organization that has been targeted very recently due to the run-up to the current election. And really, their concern right now is being able to respond with the team that they have 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for the next really week and a half until the news breaks about who the next president will be in the United States. And we've seen this time and time again where organizations that focused on that capability, now automation, really reap the benefits and the best outcomes from their security tooling. Really, because they're not so heavily focused on making one thing do everything, they're able to leverage all the capabilities across their entire suite of products, buying the best of breed, integrating with each other, and making sure they have a completely holistic approach to handling incidents as they come into the organization.
Got it. And I think that's an answer to, you don't need something monolithic, but you do need something flexible.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
Okay, and let's talk a little bit about, what happens when you've got sort of a new network project. So at what stage of that project, Joe, should comprehensive security be discussed, and how influential should it be when making decisions about network solutions in general?
So go back to the five pillars that we talked about with the CIA triad. And for any network project, you want to make sure that security is built in from the beginning. Very similar to now, when you start talking about coding, the huge effort that was underway the last, I would say, 5 to 10 years to make sure that you code it properly and it's securely in fashion. So any product that you release would have a lower threat vector in terms of being, in terms of being breached. Can you hear me?
Yes, absolutely. Yep.
Okay, sorry about that. And I think if you do not actually bring security front and center in the beginning, then you're going to have to backtrack, and you may find out that some of the direction that you took in deploying your new network, name it, that you have to rethink it, and it's harder to integrate once you've actually made purchases, when you started building out your infrastructure. So it needs to be front and center day one. But use the triad, the five pillars, and I think that will guide you going forward and help you make the right decisions and integrate into what you already have in your environment.
So to a degree, it kind of helps even guide the direction of the network somewhat. I mean, at least that's what it sounds like.
Yeah, yeah.
And Eric, what's your perspective?
Yeah, I completely agree with Joe's perspective here, especially in terms of building security at the early stages of the process. Now, whether that process is a new network deployment, or that process is a new application deployment, whatever it may be, really building security in the beginning really sets the stage for a successful not only deployment, but also a really robust ability to respond if an incident actually takes place. I think one thing we've seen repetitively from customers, they lack long-term monitoring of security aspects within the application, which is where arguably most of the problems lie. I mean, so in some cases, the building security in from each step of the lifecycle, including the maintenance phase, is just as important as the beginning. Primarily because obviously the application and servicing capability has its own inherent risks, so they need to be updated over a period of time. As we grow as a company, Palo Alto Networks, I joined at 1,000 people. We now have 8,000 people worldwide. We are continuously integrating and continuously monitoring all of our systems to ensure that we are not the target of an adversary, because obviously being the largest security company in the world today, we are a target. So we know we are. So we make sure that every single aspect of what we build, every single aspect of our employees and what they access is all built with that in mind. And if you think about this overall, when we talk about kind of shifting left and thinking about security at the beginning of a project, the end will be that you will come out with not only the ability to fully understand end-to-end what potential vulnerabilities, what potential scenarios may play out for an adversary, but also give you the capabilities to ensure that you're making sure that application has a complete and full security understanding moving forward as well.
So at the end of the day, the discussion's not so much at the beginning, but it's a constant. It's something you're tweaking whenever you're tweaking your network. It's essentially a discussion that never ends.
Absolutely. Never ends.
Yep. Okay.
And I want to add to that. And because you've actually incorporated it from the beginning, as new threats emerge, you now have the ability to vet your infrastructure that you tried to build securely from the beginning and understand how that new threat vector may affect you.
So that, again, it's that sort of ongoing nature. There are changes that you're going to have to answer to no matter what, and security is among the first of those needs.
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, thank you, Eric and Joe. Great conversation. Let's take a few questions from the audience. First question, Eric, you talked about a single person in getting into that healthcare organization and starting a ransomware attack. Was the point of that someone outside the network or within the network, or how did that actual infiltration take place?
Oh, yeah, great question. So the way this started, very interesting is that we were actually, as a company, we were actually positioned inside the network to see this traffic in a proof of concept. So we were monitoring their traffic passively. We were not actively interacting, but we saw essentially a single email that was delivered to a single user. Now, that single email included a business document, as I kind of alluded to or we showed a slide on before. That single document included a malicious macro. So when that single user received that single email, opened up that particular document and executed that macro, it indeed called out to a number of compromised URLs to pull down a secondary executable. So the executable, when it executed on the user's machine, it actually sat dormant. So it immediately figured out, and the adversary's tactics here were very, very smart. They figured out that I don't want to be noisy. I'm going to take a period of time where I do nothing. Just sit quietly, and the command and control, so the way they were controlling the machine remotely for the single user, was over an SSL encrypted tunnel. So they built SSL encrypted tunnels with the malware they installed locally, and then were communicating with this user very, very infrequently during the day. Since this person was actually at a terminal inside of the hospital or inside of the healthcare organization, they would actually activate and start communicating with that device overnight. So they would specifically look for periods of time where it was a bit dormant, not a lot of activity, and actually leverage that time frame, because also they knew that the, shall we say, tier one security operations analysts weren't available or weren't watching, so to speak. So once they were able to figure out where they were, what they had access to through a single user and the single SSL-based communication channel, that is when they figured out there was actually a shared backup account. So in this case, again, machines were all connected together. There was a shared account being used for backups across the entire environment. They then leveraged, and this is very interesting, we saw this distinctly in the traffic we saw, leveraged that backup account to then move laterally and push ransomware from a single point out to, I think in this case, about 250 to 300 different machines that were adjacent. So right next to each other on that single network segment. And that was the entirety. In this case, it took about 3 days from start to finish before the ransomware deployment, which again was after hours. I think it started like 12:14 a.m. on a Sunday evening is when with a large-scale deployment.
And it sounds as though the hacker almost stayed hidden within the system and worked very hard to kind of be low-key throughout this.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. They were very, very smart. And again, this is not indicative of just them themselves. We're seeing this time and time again with certain malware families that behave this way, where they actively know what they're looking for. They're just waiting for the opportunity to gather that information and deploy what their final goal is.
Mm-hmm. And this next question I'll pose to both of you. Somebody has asked, what simple solution do you recommend to add to your home network to make it secure while working remotely, something that can be distributed or purchased easily and installed by employees while they're working remotely?
This is Joe. So what I have done is set up a second wireless AP, and I actually have like all my business traffic going there, and whatever I need in terms of resources locally are tied to that LAN that's on that wireless AP. And then I am able to control anything coming in. So anything that's tried, if it's on the regular home IP address, whether it's IoT, whatever have you, if I ever have an issue and they're trying to scan, they would never be able to get into that wireless network that I've created. I think that's one very simple way of segregating your traffic in your house, because typically it's wide open to everyone and everybody who comes in, including your guest network at times. So friends come over, they're using your wireless. You know, I think that's one way. Mm-hmm. Then you can start getting into maybe, usually when you typically access your corporate network, you know, you're locked down to just your local broadcast domain as well. So again, that's something that you can do if you're using that separate AP. I think that's a real easy way to start off, just segmenting your traffic from the start.
I agree with Joe here. And in some cases, I know, for example, some of the Comcast available Wi-Fi access points actually have the ability of setting up secondary access points within the same unit. Actually did this for myself here at home. I'm a Comcast business customer, just like most of you guys here on this call. And I actually have the same exact setup. So I actually have a separate access point or a separate broadcast that's just for me. It's just for my machines that connect to my corporate network. And here at Palo Alto Networks, I have an always-on VPN. So my laptop, when it boots up, it immediately connects to secure resources in our corporate environment, and I do not disconnect. So I keep myself fully tunneled through basically the security aspects of the company that obviously I work for. Now, you can expand this out a bit and think about other technologies that you personally can use, such as, you know, multi-factor authentication devices. You know, a lot of different services now have available to you MFA capabilities, which I think is just as important as separating yourself logically network-wise. At the same time, also educating yourself on how some adversaries use social engineering, use phishing sites. You know, take a look. I mean, there's kind of interesting. If you start looking around online, you'll find a lot of different resources about coaching, just more education aspects about security that can really help you to be a good decision when something seems a bit fishy. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Joe, at one point you referenced a threshold situation. How do you define a threshold situation?
I'm a bit of a sci-fi buff, so I think of threshold from Stargate, the series, where you actually have. So let's talk about the life cycle of the attack that Eric had actually talked about earlier. So when you have that first URL where the person was actually clicked on it, they actually went to the bad site, they downloaded some files that then started going out and creeping across the network, that is the threshold. That is them actually getting a foothold in your organization. And at that point, the malware, or if it's a command and control from somebody that's remote coming into like a healthcare situation, now they're going to actually go beyond that threshold and go to other locations in your network, try to do it off hours, have that encrypted channel. So that's what I consider. Now, if you have the proper controls in place in your network, then you should be able to detect that, mitigate that almost immediately, or at least alert somebody that says, there's something that looks wrong here. This is not normal traffic at this time. We need to investigate.
Okay, and Eric, early on in the presentation, you had mentioned triaging. So what type of technology can aid with triaging, and under what circumstances is it used?
Yeah, so there's actually a number of different techniques and applications available. I mean, the simplest form is, you know, an analyst looking at a situation or interpreting a situation. Maybe it's an AV event, maybe it's a firewall event, maybe it's a combination of the two, and really trying to connect the dots to make sure that there's not a larger event happening in that space. Now, when you talk about a human, you know, doing that work, obviously there are problems with scaling, especially when it comes to large-scale environments, which is where applications like SOAR products, which involves security orchestration automation applications come into play, where basically they will read the actual traffic and read information coming from different sources and interpret that information and decide that it should be based upon some parameters, but a decision-making process based upon that to take an action or not. But here at our own SOC, at Palo Alto Networks, we have a product that does exactly that, that we sell to enterprise customers. Our own SOC uses that product exclusively. So as an example, when I receive a phishing email, I have an automatic button inside of my email box. I click, it reports a phishing email to our security operations center. Our security operations center has an automated system that will actually read my email, read the information inside my email, and will then reach into other email boxes and remove that email on demand, or actually in real time, essentially, from everyone else's that may have received that particular phishing email. That's a great example of no human interaction. I'm the human. I'm the one making decisions saying this is phishing. Based upon that information, the SOC analyst or the SOC team is automatically removing that threat from the entirety of the organization.
So again, kind of the among the benefits of automation.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And Joe, you had mentioned the CIA triad in terms of the five pillars. Is authentication sort of a ground zero protection? And in your view, what is the most effective form?
I would say it's authentication, because you need you need your employees to work. You need them to add their productivity to the company, but you got to make sure that it is your employee. It's not somebody who's in your environment wreaking havoc or stealing your data. So it's definitely ground zero. There is multi-factor authentication. A lot of, for example, if I actually log into my corporate network, I actually have to, I get authenticated on my phone. So two-factor there. Some places, depending on the data that you're accessing, it wants biometrics, you know, so your finger, your eyes. I've seen that a lot in a lot of data centers. But now even with some of the laptops, you have the ability to read your fingerprints. So that is definitely key, because you want to make sure people are who they say they are before you actually give them the data. Because once, if you don't do that, then the data is exfiltrated and it's out of your control.
So that I would imagine biometrics are very, very powerful. If you look at facial recognition and the like, along with fingerprint, I would imagine it's hard to beat that.
Right. And I want to say this. You know, the interesting part is the things that we have talked about like 10, 20 years ago in terms of security, authentication, authorization, all those things, now they're becoming much more commonplace. If you want to go onto your iPhone, you just hold it up to your face and they'll scan you. You know, right. So it's becoming cheaper. It's becoming a commodity that people use, and it's starting to just become part of our lifestyle.
And yeah, I watch my kids do it every day, and it's amazing. And I will say, I think it's gotten better, because if, for example, one of them puts on their glasses, the phone won't recognize them. They have to do it the way they've originally done it, which I think is a great way to keep it online. Mm-hmm. And finally, for both of you, do you have a good example of a sound or good VPN protection solution? And we'll start with you, Eric.
Ooh, well, you know, our company, Palo Alto Networks, we sell both a large scale and small scale VPN solution. So I will vote for ourselves for that. However, there are a number of open source applications, meaning availability, you know, code audited, externally available for free applications available out there. OpenVPN is the first that comes to mind. Again, a little bit more challenging to set up than a commercial product, but once set up, just as secure as, you know, an enterprise-related product as well. And again, there's lots of different technologies out there. I would first start with what is really the end goal? Is it to protect the applications inside the environment, to protect the users, and focus on that? Because to Joe's point, MFA could actually solve a number of problems without requiring a VPN. If done properly, if your applications are living in the cloud, like take for example, I access Salesforce and other different cloud-based applications, they're not behind my VPN. They just have MFA authentication that's very tightly controlled to my account. So there's anomaly detection. If I log in for all of a sudden from Indonesia, where I just logged in from the United States today, that actually will cause a red flag and not authenticate. These are really great examples of maybe circumventing a typical VPN process and still being able to deliver the security outcomes that you would like.
Mm-hmm. And Joe, any thoughts on VPN solution?
As a Comcast business, we work a lot of VPN vendors, so I'm not going to name one per se, but I will say this. One, yes, if you are like Eric and you're accessing the applications and you have multi-factor, that may take care of some of the issues. But if you're going with a VPN, I would say make sure it's something that is vetted, whether that means it's open source and it's vetted by the open source community. If it's a corporate entity, making sure that they have a good run in business in terms of, okay, they have updated their software. Historically, there's not a lot of issues with their code base, and you can usually find these things. And then how they tie into the different authentication source. Active Directory, if you're doing username and password or something along those lines, or if you can do maybe even your own digital certificates, if you are able to leverage that. So I would say definitely look at the product first and then all the feature sets and how it ties into your overall security strategy. I think those are the key things. And then you'll find the right vendor.
Joe, Eric, thank you very much for a great conversation today. And thank you, everyone in the audience, for attending the webinar today. I think it was a great discussion, and I really appreciate everyone's time. On behalf of all of us at Comcast Business, I hope you have a great day, and thanks again.